So today is November 20th, and I'm here with Pastor David Hsu from West Houston Chinese Church, and I will be interviewing him on behalf of Houston Asian American Archive from Rice University. So to first start off, we're going to kind of learn about your childhood. Can you tell us about where and when you were born?
Yeah, I was born in Taipei, Taiwan, in 1965.
Mm-hmm.
And our family later on, I immigrated to the U.S. When I was 14.
Perfect. And do you have any siblings?
Yeah, I have a sister and a brother, I'm the oldest. Uh-huh. And so three kids. And we after we immigrated to the U.S., we grew up in the Boston area.
Okay, perfect. And were they also born in Taiwan? And
then... Yes, we were all born overseas. And okay. All kind of grew up, and I went through high school here, and my siblings, that, you know, they were younger, yeah.
Okay, okay. Do you remember anything from your childhood in Taiwan specifically?
I do. What would you want to know?
any like childhood memories that you had?
Yeah. I do have a number of childhood memories because growing up in Taiwan, I grew up in the church. My parents are believers. Mm-hmm. So my earliest mm-hmm. memory were in the church. I was a pretty mediocre student. Mm-hmm. I played basketball. I collected bugs. I was a kid. I used to go with some friends, and we were collecting butterfly and dragonfly samples. I was pretty blessed as a child. I didn't really remember many bad things other than until right before we were about to immigrate, when my father passed away when I was 12. Mm. And then grandparents who lived with us also passed away. Mm. So I guess that the last couple of years there became harder. Mm-hmm. And it was after my father passed away I did not even know, but my mom had been talking to my uncle about us immigrating as a family to the U.S. And okay. We did that when I was 14.
Okay. And then so your uncle was already in the U.S.?
Yes.
And so he's going to spawn. Okay. Cool. And so what year did you move to the U.S.? So 19...
Well, we came to the U.S. In 1979.
Okay. Okay. And then you moved to Boston first.
Right. We were originally in New York City. A little bit. Okay. That was a little scary in the beginning, and then we because my other uncle, one of my uncles worked in New York City, uh-huh. and then so we were with him for a little while, and then later on we moved to Boston. We were in the suburb.
Okay. And was there any other reason for your family to move to the U.S.?
I think it's probably very similar to many Chinese families. Uh-huh. After my father passed away, I think actually even before then, my mom and dad had actually talked about the possibility of our family immigrating. But I think my mom would not leave without my dad. And right. After my dad passed away, I think they really immigrated because of the decision is really for our sake, thinking that there would mm-hmm. be a better future mm-hmm. for us. I think right. in a way, also for my mom, she felt like maybe just kind of a new star on life. Mm-hmm. And then I think there's some sad memory definitely was that grandparents passing there. So we came over, 1979. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And did you and your family know any English when you guys moved?
My mom, very little. All of us, very little. But I had, you know, in junior high, I started taking English.
Okay.
But my English was bad. It was bad. Yeah, we had to learn one. So that first 2 years in US, in New York and in Boston, uh-huh. I walked around with a dictionary. literally I carried a little dictionary with me. That's before phone days and stuff, like electronic yeah. dictionary.
Yeah.
So yeah, I worked hard wanting to learn the language
mm-hmm.
well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And what do you think helped you most to learn English right after you moved to the U.S.?
Apart from the grace of God, I would say when I was in New York City, I didn't learn very much because uh-huh. there were just so many Chinese speaking kids there. Like,
yeah.
like the, I was right away introduced to like the, in my junior high, there's like half the cafeteria that were speaking Chinese. And then, but then when we moved to Boston, mm-hmm. We were in the suburb and there was no one.
Oh,
so, and so now you have yeah. to kind of sink or swim. And yeah. I felt like a big part of that learning had to do with just a very different environment. Mm-hmm. And I had a very sweet elderly Jewish ESL teacher, Mrs. Aronson, mm. who I love very much and who cared for me very much. Mm-hmm. And my first 2 years of being in ESL classes was her. I thought she was a terrific teacher. And mm-hmm. yeah, that was really a blessing for me.
Yeah, that's great. And how about like overall, how was your integration process into like the American culture, getting used to the lifestyle?
I think probably, you know, the high school and college years were the years where I really kind of right. assimilated. High school a little bit, but because, you know, I was living at home and stuff, I wouldn't say totally, but I would say the first 2 years in college, being away from home,
mm-hmm.
being with living in the dorms with friends, I felt like that's when I really kind of fit in, because in high school there were some hard times too, like getting picked yeah. on and things like that.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. So when you like kind of got picked on in high school, do you think that was kind of directed towards you because, as an Asian American or as an Asian student, I guess, or was that just more in
yeah,
general?
I think it's probably a combination of all these things. I think
mm-hmm.
it was probably you know, I was a nerdy kid, that maybe that's part mm-hmm. of it. I think the Asian part of it, probably there were very few Asian mm. kids mm-hmm. in my school. I was being challenged to Kung Fu matches often. I didn't even know Kung Fu, but they wanted to fight with me. Uh-huh. So and then there was some kid from Hong Kong who actually knew some Kung Fu and got into a fight with them. And and they ganged up on him, beat him up. And so I always just recognize, okay, I didn't know Kung Fu, and I try to stay away. But yeah, there was definitely, we didn't use those terms, and there was not that level of awareness about bullying and stuff like that. Mm-hmm,
yeah.
But there was a lot of that going on. Yeah.
I see. And was that kind of, I guess, accepted as normal back then? Because I know, like, you know, in recent years, it's
yeah, sensitive. I think I accept it as normal. It never occurred to me that I should report the kids who were yeah. doing that to me. Mm-hmm. It always felt like if I had reported them, I always feared that things may get worse for me.
Uh-huh,
so it was usually just kind of take it on the chin and walk mm-hmm. away, walk mm-hmm. away.
That's
yeah. You know, especially those first 2 years in high school in Western Massachusetts, where I just felt like I need to learn the language. I still don't know my way around. I'm mm-hmm. just really learning a lot of things. I just felt like I just need to figure this thing out. And mm-hmm. I think as I became a better student and gradually things got better as I became junior and senior year.
Uh-huh.
I had gotten back into kind of classes with my peers, because before that I was usually placed in like regular classes and not like the accelerated classes or the college bound classes. So I got bullied a lot. And then I think later on when I was in my AP classes and things like that, that reduced quite a bit more.
Yeah. Interesting. That's interesting. Do you think you were like really academically focused in high school?
I was a total nerd. I mean, I always felt like if I do better, maybe I can pull myself out of some of that that kind of ridicule or that kind of disrespect or things like that.
And did you participate in any extracurriculars?
A few, only at the insistence of my teacher for my own sake, because you know, just very self-conscious, feeling like, you know, my English wasn't very good. I was my first 2 years, I really didn't do anything. I was just trying to fit in and get into school. But in the junior and senior year, my teacher became aware that I wasn't, you know, doing that and pushed me. Mm-hmm. So I joined some clubs and things like that. Mm-hmm. But they felt like, at that stage, they felt like things I just had to do. It wasn't more like I love to do it because I want to do something I love. So when my kids are in high school or join clubs or sports and things like that, I envy them because, you know, they were doing things that they really loved.
Right.
And at that time for me, it was really just, I just felt like I was just trying to, it was really kind of a survival mindset. I would say until I went to college, I really felt like I survived high school.
Yeah, that's funny. And so like what specific extracurriculars did you take part in or any sports?
I think I was in some sort of the key club. It was some sort of club that helps the community. Some language club. And just a few things. Just to make sure that I have something to put on my application. and it wasn't enough.
So yeah. Okay. Interesting. And did your mom ever have like influences on your academics or maybe the extracurriculars as well that you were part of?
Not really. My mom have always been a housewife. Mm-hmm. My dad, after my dad passed away, and my mom only had a high school education.
Okay.
And you know, I think by the grace of God, like myself, my siblings, we were all kind of just self-starters in that area. Like mom usually didn't have to push us about school. And I think maybe when dad was alive, they actually did some. But I would say after my dad left, passed away, I think my mom was cared more about us just loving each other and love God. And I never really recall being pushed. Although I did push myself. I did push myself and my aspiration was trying to get into an Ivy League school. Like many, yes.
Right, exactly. And so I guess what was like kind of the culture within your family, kind of like the dynamics? Was it like very close? Were you very close with your siblings and your parents and such?
Yeah, I would say, you know, we were close. We were not like very, very close, but we were close. And I think, you know, not having our dad kind of resulted in that we didn't have tons of friends outside, especially those early years. We played with each other or just made a little bit with neighbors, but even not that much. So even till today, you know, I would say we're close, and my siblings we have good relationship. My mom, I think one thing my mom always trying to talk to us about is how important it is to love each other. Some of the horror memory I recall when my grandfather was dying, and my mom's siblings were there, and they were arguing about, you know, who's paying for what or caring for this, and there was some harsh memory of that, and I think that was also in the back of my mind to see that, you know, when a family is not caring about each other, that just didn't look that great at all. And so I felt like I was very fortunate, even though I lost my dad early. I felt like we as a family were pretty close, and you know, I was close to my mom being the oldest too.
That's great. And so like after moving from Taiwan, were there any, did you guys still celebrate those traditional like holidays and such?
For a long time, because we lived far from Chinatown, and where we were, you know, there's definitely no like H Mart or 99 Ranch or stuff like that store. We didn't even know what day Chinese New Year was. So it was until like much later where mm-hmm. there were just more Chinese people where at the town that we were at. And we got more in the Chinese church. My mom was part of the people that helped start a Chinese church in our town. And mm-hmm. It started like a Bible study. And so we became to be more aware of that. But no, I would say we gave up most of the Chinese holidays and things. And being after my father passed away, when we moved over here, my mom worked, taking care of other people's kids. And then later on, she worked on kind of the assembly line for like a PC board constructions and things like that for a number of years until I started working. Mm-hmm. So our finances were always, we were not like destitute or anything, but we lived a pretty simple life. We hardly ate out and things like that. So we didn't even give red envelopes. We didn't know what day Chinese New Year was.
That's funny. Okay, interesting. And so when you guys moved to the U.S., did you guys immediately start like going to a church, or how did that kind of happen?
Yes, we did. That was the most important thing. My mom thought that was just the most important thing in the world would be just we need to grow up in a church. Mm-hmm. And the big deal every week when I was in high school was mom driving us to church, because the Chinese church that we went to, the closest one, was still like 45 minutes away.
Wow.
And so and my mom is a kind of a timid driver, so I still remember going out to church. Mom want to go early, that was something that my mom would not compromise, was the fact that we had to go to church.
Yeah. And how is that kind of like growing up, just being in a Chinese church in America specifically?
There were different stages. When we were in high school first, but before we had our own church in our own town, I would say going to the larger Chinese church in Boston, which is a church kind of like HCC, it was large. Mm-hmm. We were really just kind of attending. And a lot of time after church, my mom just grabbed the church lunch and we just quickly get going because we knew people, we knew some people, but we didn't have many friends. Mm-hmm. But when we started their own fellowship in town and eventually started Sunday service at the Framingham, this town that we were at, and we first started in elementary school that was right across the street from where we lived. Uh-huh. So our families were always one of the first families to get there. And my first thing during those days was to line up the chairs. We would go there early to line up the chairs. Yeah. And we would be the last ones to leave to put away the chairs.
That's nice.
That's funny. So in church, in later church planting and things like that, that really brought back memories.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. And so what part, I guess, when did you start having that idea of becoming a pastor or like going into ministry?
Later.
Later.
High school, I was an electrical engineering major. At a certain point, I began to have certain ambition. I thought maybe I could invent something or have my own company one day or something like that. That was the kind of dream that I had for myself.
Okay.
Until probably about senior year in college, where I think the transition point was I attended the second CNC conference out in DC. Mm-hmm. And it was for the first time I was challenged with the idea that God may want to do something different with my life. Mm-hmm. And I answered the altar call to pray about what God may want. Mm-hmm. And I remember I was quite frightened by the fact that I raised my hand. And then about 2 years later, when I was working, I attended Urbana. And that was again a affirmation where I felt like it was that point I felt like my future was not in engineering, and I God wanted me to do something different. Although at first I thought maybe I could be a tent maker and maybe teach in a university someplace or in China or someplace like that. But sometime after that, I became convinced that I wanted to be more equipped in the Word of God. And when I went to seminary, that's when the pastoral ministry and its needs. And when I think back about what the local church life had meant to me, that became something that I became interested and sensed the call to.
And so what college did you go to again?
I went to a school called Tufts University in Boston. Yeah.
Okay, cool. And then what kind of made you decide to go there?
Scholarship.
What did you like?
My big thing for people who know my story was that my dream school was MIT. I was waitlisted there. But I got accepted at Tufts and got a very nice scholarship. And that was a very, very important thing for us.
Yeah.
And so actually, when I decided to go to Tufts, I decided to go there sight unseen. because it was just, I applied for just a couple places and it just seemed like, okay, we'll go there. We'll see what that looks like. Yeah.
Interesting. That's funny. And so you study electrical engineering, right? And what kind of made you decide to go into that major?
Not sure. I was a electrical engineering and physics a major.
Wow.
I was interested in physics, but I wasn't sure there were jobs in physics at that time. I was in engineering school. I felt like I wasn't as good at mechanical engineering. I felt like chemical engineering might be kind of dangerous. And I didn't think about those other later on, biomedical or the other fancy stuff. So I just thought electrical engineering just seems like a natural place to be because, I was a little geeky. I like play video games, play computer stuff. And that just seemed like the natural place to go.
Mm-hmm.
So that was what I did.
Used it. Yeah. And what communities were you part of in college? Any other clubs you were part of?
Yeah, my first 2 years in college, I wasn't in a lot of community. I was just in the dorm with a lot of people in an all guys dorm, and in a not a very God honoring lifestyle either, because I was really a little unhappy with God. I was a little unhappy with the fact that I wasn't at MIT. And I really felt like my first 2 years that I had something to prove. So I studied really hard. I hung out with the people that seemed cool in the dorm. I particularly stayed away from Asian American and Asian American groups.
I see.
I think it's all a part of maybe coming out of high school, being picked on and all that. I just really, really wanted to fit in with the cool people.
Right.
And so I still remember I was invited to these Asian functions and stuff like that. I usually just totally dismissed them. I never even bothered.
Yeah.
And I wasn't even involved with any campus Christian organization or things. I went to church because I felt like it was an obligation. I'm a Christian. I need to go to church. But at my church, which is a big church in Boston, there were a lot of MIT people there. And that didn't sit well with me at all. I wasn't very involved. My first 2 years, any community I was involved in was all academic or just some fun things with the with friends. I played a lot of frisbee golf, a lot of different some sports things, some different stuff. But I had I was distant from God, and I was maybe even a little bit upset.
Right. Yeah. And so, was there any point where you kind of started drifting towards those Asian American communities again?
Yeah, I would say the my journey shifted started my junior year toward the end of February end of my sophomore year. when, you know, we were in an all guys dorm.
Mm-hmm.
There were a lot of pornography.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of times, sometimes people get drunk, pull the fire alarm, and at an all guys dorm, you see like right. just tons of girls came out. And so, toward the end of my sophomore year, I became convicted that I wasn't living like who Jesus wanted me to.
Mm-hmm.
And that was not who I was supposed to be.
Mm-hmm.
So I restarted reading the Bible,
mm-hmm.
and I became convicted that I needed a change of pace.
Mm-hmm.
So junior year, I roomed together with a group of guys who were a little different. And I was really, you know, a fairly shy, introverted person.
Right.
But for some reason, I saw a flyer for an Asian American Bible study, mm-hmm. and I just went uninvited.
Right.
And I met some of my best friends from college, mm-hmm. there. It was a very small group. I mean, compared yeah. to like Rice or UT, I mean, what we're talking about, you know, when we have seven people, that's a great fellowship. You know, we're usually it's about four or five people. That's just how small mm-hmm. it was.
Mm-hmm.
But starting my junior year, you know, I started studying the Bible again. I started really having Christian community and fellowship again. And because some of the guys went to a different church, and I went with them to this church in Chinatown together, and I got involved at the church college fellowship as well, got involved in the leadership team there, and that's how I actually started getting back connected with the Asian American community. I would say mm-hmm. that it started by going back to my faith. And then that's how I went back into the Asian
American.
It wasn't so much just what I was looking for to get back to, but I think that there may have been a desire or a hunger inside that I wasn't aware of.
That's interesting. Yeah, interesting. Okay, cool. And then so after you graduated, where did you go again?
After I graduated, I worked as a semiconductor company called Analog Devices in Boston.
Okay.
I actually had wanted to go to grad school. I applied mm-hmm. for MIT again. I got waitlisted again. I was most unhappy. Mm-hmm. Although I was very blessed, I actually had received a fellowship, a full paying fellowship for my master's study. So my professor had asked me if I would just go and take that fellowship offer to school. Yeah. They would let me in, but my pride was too hurt. I have too much hurt pride at that point. I said, that's it. I'll never go to MIT. I'm gonna work for a couple of years, and I'm going West Coast in a couple of years.
Uh-huh.
And so I asked the fellowship. I requested a deferment on my fellowship. Mm-hmm. And I decided to get a little bit of work experience first. But there was another reason in that is family. Because mm-hmm. at that time, my brother also went out to college. So my mm-hmm. mom was by herself at home. Mm-hmm. And her English was just never really that good. And right. you know, we talked about it, and I just felt like it's not a good idea for mom to live by herself. So I decided that I will move back home to live with mom. Mm-hmm. And I will work a couple of years, and then I will go to grad school again. So so I started working as a product engineer at Analog Devices. Uh-huh.
Okay, cool. And then did you ever end up going to grad school, or did you go to seminary?
No, after 2 years, I quit and went to seminary.
That's funny. And so I think from what I remember, you mentioned like when you first started thinking about going into seminary and going to ministry, that was like late college, I think you said. Or was
yes,
that while
yes,
you were working?
Yes, yes. Senior year in college, I started considering the possibility that God may have something different for me to do.
Right, right.
But when I started working in that, it became more clear to me that, this is, I don't want to do this the rest of my life. I was not happy. I felt, it's a really dumb thing. I felt I was too smart for the job they gave me to do. I was too good for that. And my boss could tell about that. And they moved me. So I got moved after a year from product engineering to design engineering. So I started learning about computer chip design work. So I was given a mentor to work under the mentor for chip design work and given my first project, a redesign project. And at that time, I was really seriously considering seminary. But but the question in my mind was that, do I just need a new job or am I really called to ministry?
Right.
And it's just not clear to me. And so I was praying and I felt, and when I was given that job to go into design, I felt like that was an answer to prayer. I felt like I really just want to see what I love this job. And it was really interesting because I had to work really, really hard during that time. Because my first year as product engineer, I felt like I just coasted. There's really not much to do. Everything was so simple. But I was doing the design engineering work. There was a lot of things I didn't know because I had never taken a master level training in VLSI design or any of those things.
Right.
So I had to learn a lot of things on the run. And I found that I really loved it. I really loved the work a lot more. But I felt like God also showed me that even though I enjoy the work, it was still not what I wanted to do. I wanted to do something else. And so I felt like God gave me that opportunity to confirm for me that I indeed had a sense of calling and I want to go and do something different.
Yeah, that's great. And then so you quit and then went to seminary in Dallas, right?
Yes.
Right. Okay. And then I guess, so did you move to Dallas? So you moved to Dallas and then went to seminary there. What about like your siblings and your mom?
Yeah. When I 2 years later, my sister graduated from college.
Okay.
And she moved back home. And I talked to my sister. And this is another thing where I was just so blessed. Like my siblings are just so supportive of each other. And my sister just right away say, you know, you go. You know, I'll take care of mom. And don't worry. And so and my mom was also very gracious and supportive. Once she heard about I had an interest in going to seminary, and she just started praying for me. And she just said, you know, go, don't worry about me.
Right.
And so when I hear, you know, a lot of time for Asian Americans that want to go into ministry, it's a real struggle with their families.
Right.
And I have a very blessed story because my family are just very supportive. So my sister moved back home and I moved to Dallas.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then I guess starting out in seminary, did you have any specific ministry that you wanted to work in at that time, or were you just kind of there?
No, I didn't know. I had no idea. I just realized that I needed to have a lot of growing to do. You know, there wasn't much to do. There was a lot of needs in youth ministry. So I just jumped right into youth ministry there. I actually had done a little bit of that back in Boston. During that 2 years I was working, I started helping out. I moved after Urbana when I was there. I moved back home to our home church in Framingham, the small church. Because I wanted to be in Boston because everybody my same age, my peers are all there. And at the suburban church where I grew up in, there's no one my age. They're all families, you know, and it's just kids. But after Urbana, I was really convicted. I felt like, okay, I cannot speak of wanting to do any ministry if I can't go back to my home church to help. So I made a decision that on Friday night, I would go after work into the city to have fellowship with my peers. But on Sunday and Saturday, I would serve in my home church in the suburb. So I actually became a deacon. I helped with youth ministry. I translated sermons, and when I went to seminary, I continued to do some of that that work and was continued to be involved in youth ministry at that time.
So
actually was using mostly English and doing English ministry.
So in Dallas, did you also attend like a Chinese or Asian American church?
Yes, I did. I went to the Dallas Chinese Bible Church, DCBC.
Okay.
And I was there for all 4 years, and just really blessed at that church. was involved with Learn, did a youth ministry internship under Pastor Ed Lee, who was at Fort Bend, and then later on went to the Mosaic Church.
Okay.
And then over there, I also got involved with some evangelistic Bible study at the medical school, at Southwestern Medical School, where another seminarian and I would go in there and do Bible study with some of the mainland Chinese there. Mm-hmm. And so that was the first place I started using Chinese again in the ministry. Because up to this point, I had pretty much kind of dropped Chinese. You know, I'm just pretty much in the English-speaking world. And but that needs a restart. And also because I was doing some translation. And I used to do mostly is that in my home church was that the Chinese speaker would come. And in the youth, we didn't have an English speaker. So I would translate the Chinese message into English. Mm. But when I was at DCBC, they actually asked me sometimes to translate from English to Chinese. So that kind of forced me to kind of start working on that. And you know, in retrospect, you know, God kind of had a purpose in all of that to kind of make, to, so that I didn't lose all of it.
And so I'm curious to hear, like, when you went to Dallas and then you kind of like had your own, you had your own independence in choosing what church to go to. Why did you choose specifically a Chinese church rather than like a non-Chinese church?
Yeah, it's a great question. My pastor, while I was in Boston during the last 2 years in college in Chinatown, Pastor Stephen Chin, he had, after I graduated from college, he had went back to DTS to finish his studies. Because apparently he didn't finish all his study. So when I went to Dallas, he just finished his study and he was coming back to going back to Boston. So I got reconnected with Pastor Steve, and so he introduced me to some of the other Chinese students and that. For some reason, it never occurred to me to kind of go to say a there are many great churches in Dallas area, like Tony Evans Church. I mean, churches that I would really love to learn more about. But somehow I just felt like there was a lot of needs in the Chinese church. And during those days, especially those who are doing youth and English ministry, are very few and far in between. Most churches don't have that. Even if you want to hire somebody, you can't find somebody. So somehow I just felt like, okay, that seemed like a area that I can serve. And and so I just plugged in right there. And and I have to say, you know, I've really grown to, I think those are the years where I have kind of started really developing a love for the Chinese church, seeing all the warts and the problems as well as the good.
And was there anyone or like any moment, any event that kind of inspired you to become a pastor?
I'm not sure if there was a single moment that did that, but I think the time there was people. And I do know that I enjoy working on preaching. I felt like I enjoy being with people. And it seemed like there were not enough pastors. And so it just feel like it almost didn't feel like a conscious decision where I just choose pastoring over something else. And somehow when I started doing it, I also thought that maybe I wouldn't do it for the rest of my life, that I may still go back to do missions or something overseas or in Asia someplace. But it just happened. I enjoyed being with people. I enjoyed teaching and preaching. And I learned, I didn't know about leadership, but I felt like I've learned about that. And it just felt like a good fit. And over the years, I think I look back, I felt like, yeah, it is a good fit. But back then, I didn't really think that way. It just seemed to me like, Yeah, that seemed like a natural thing to do.
Yeah, so I guess it wasn't like a hard decision either.
It wasn't a hard decision.
It was just kind of a decision. Interesting. Okay, and so after you graduated from seminary, where did you go? Did you go to WHCC?
Yeah, actually, my old church in Boston, the small church mm-hmm. that I was in, growing up there, there was always a lot of like stories, drama, issues and things. So, and you hear a lot of, and when you're in school, you hear a lot about like horror stories about church, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. especially Chinese church, people conflict, right. church splits, all yeah. this other stuff. So honest truth, in the circle that we're in, I mean, Chinese church doesn't have the best reputation. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And I was at DTS, and one of my best friend there, Greg Wong, mm-hmm. he was a former missionary supported by HCC, and he had always talked about HCC, Houston Chinese Church, as how great it is. And it just puzzled me, because I never hear people say great things about the Chinese church. I say, you know, I've got to take a look at this. Mm-hmm. So I actually wrote a letter to HCC mm-hmm. and asked if I could intern one summer at Houston mm-hmm. Chinese Church.
Okay.
Well, they wrote me back and said, well, there was no room for internship, but they're starting a new church called uh-huh. West Houston. They said, how right. about if you go there and intern? And I was like, hey, I want to go to HCC. I don't know what this WHCC is. I'm not interested in that. Uh-huh. So I just said, well, no thanks. So my last year in seminary, I actually went back home to Boston mm-hmm. and helped at my home church there. Mm-hmm. But I was invited to by WCC to speak at a church retreat, their church retreat as the English youth speaker.
Uh-huh.
So
okay.
So it was right at the I was at DTS for 4 years. So it was my my fourth year. I was I spoke there over Labor Day weekend, and it was just mm-hmm. It just met so many great people there, mm-hmm. and they just asked me to say, hey, you know, you want to come down during the regular school year and help us out? We have a lot of mm-hmm. youth, we need a lot of help, and this is when WCC just got started,
right?
So they asked me if I would go down there weekly. I said, I can go weekly. That'll kill me. And, yeah. and so they were very persistent. They were like, well, how about like every other week? I was like, every other week, that's still pretty hard too. And then mm-hmm. they were like, oh, okay. And they'll say like, how about if you come once a month? Well, I said, you know, that sounds a little more reasonable. But I said, you know, I don't even have a car. and so they said, oh no, you don't need a car. We'll just fly you down. So, uh-huh. so my last year at Dallas Seminary, W flew me down. I flew on Southwest. They booked early, get the cheap, back in those days, the cheap round trip fare. Uh-huh. And I will fly down and pick up a rental car, drive to WCC, help with Friday Night Fellowship, Saturday getting involved visiting kids and doing discipleship, Sunday morning teach Sunday school, speak, and Sunday afternoon doing meetings. And then fly back to Dallas on Sunday afternoon. Mm-hmm. So after a year of that, I never interviewed anywhere. once again, I didn't really interview or things. It just felt like, you know, I've really grown to love those people and the kids there, they were just really great. They say, mm-hmm. hey, how about you just come down and be our youth or English pastor?
Right.
And I said, yeah, that sounds like a great idea.
So you didn't have to like apply or anything? They just kind of asked.
Well,
you.
I did apply. But
okay.
I never applied like elsewhere. Like my wife asked me, like, how come you didn't apply elsewhere? How come you didn't consider other? How come you didn't think about California? It's like just didn't really occur to me.
Yeah, that's funny. Okay, so you've been there. So how long has been like WCC been formed when you started there?
I got there the second year at WCC.
Oh wow. Okay.
So yeah. So, you know, I started full time at WCC in 93. and okay. WCC was planted in 91. So,
okay.
But in 92, I was already interning there the whole
Okay, right.
Right.
Okay. And so WCC was HCC's first church plant, right?
No.
Oh.
The first church plant will be Clear Lake.
Okay.
And then WCC will be the second one. And then Fort Bend will be the third one.
I see. Okay. And then what about, do you know anything about like the one in Kazakhstan? I don't know.
Yes.
Was that later?
Yes. That actually happened, I think, in between, right around the time W was planted and right before that, where I don't know the exact year. But I would become more aware of that because Pastor Chu, who was involved with that, later on will become one of our staff.
Okay.
So Kazakhstan is also the peace church HCC have planted. Yes.
Okay, cool. And then I guess what was the purpose of HCC planting WHCC in that area?
You know, I think a big part of that DNA was just that, you know, Houston was becoming a bigger enclave for Chinese Americans and Asian Americans. And, you know, from the early days of where, you know, all around Medical Center area or the old Chinatown, and then has developed into the city was developing to westward. And so as more and more family move out there, so there was this aspiration that that's planned churches out there. Mm-hmm. So HCC has always kind of had that DNA. And that was one of the things also that attracted me to when I come here, because I felt like it was very forward thinking about, you know, planting churches and starting new work. And so I still remember when I first got to WCC, we were at a rental place in an office building, and we didn't have enough classrooms. So Sunday morning for discipleships, I would get there early and we'll bring chairs outside to the hallway because it was this hallway. So it's kind of, there's just a little bit of cover to the garage, to the parking lot. And so we will put lined up chairs in a circle and we'll do discipleship out there.
Mm-hmm.
So again, that brought back memory of when I was in high school, lining up chairs for church.
Right.
And, they're very sweet memories because those were days where I didn't have an office. We didn't have a gym. We didn't have multiple staff.
Right.
We have very little, but there were some really great people there. And so that church planting DNA in a way I felt became an important part at W2 subsequently for us, where I felt like our people from the very beginning have always said, okay, one day we're going to plant churches too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. And so when did W get their own building?
I think when I was there, maybe about a year or 2 years into it, they bought a piece of property near that office park. And about 5 years into it, I think we built our first building. So we started ministry there. I think there's more than a spiritual dynamic for this movement to plant churches. Because I think for many immigrants, there's a dual interest. There's an interest wanting to see God's name honored, and they have a place place to continue to grow in their faith. But I also think that it's also become kind of a cultural enclave, it become a home away from home.
Yeah.
So I felt like there's a real synergy that drove these early waves of church planting movement among Asian and among Chinese Americans to wanting to plant new churches. And there's also real sense of accomplishment. I don't think we can underestimate that people feel like they accomplished something living as immigrant far away from home. They're building something of their own, something they can take pride in, something they feel like mattered for eternity. And I think all these factors help drive, I think, the passion for church planting.
Yeah. So what were the interactions between WACC and I know CBC has been there too. So like, what were the interactions between W and the other Chinese churches, including like HCC and such?
Yeah, there's always a fellowship called HCCMF, which is like Houston mm-hmm. Ministerial, Houston Chinese Christian Ministerial Fellowship. Okay. And so it's kind of local Chinese pastors fellowship.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's that level of connection there, but I would say they're more cordial. And I think mm-hmm. I think that fellowship has grown over the years. I think now is I feel has matured more. But those early days, I always felt it was more cordial. You're almost like a professionals gathering of pastors, mm-hmm. and just, you know, they catch up with each other about what they're doing and things like that.
Right.
But on the English side of ministry, though, I felt like we actually had a little bit more. So when I first came, I right away visited the English pastor at CBC. I visited Pastor Fred. And mm-hmm. but during those days, Pastor Paul Epp, who was also at Houston Chinese Church, the youth pastor. Okay. And we just became great friends.
Mm-hmm.
And I would say, you know, Fred and Paul have just been not just personal friends and friends with our wives became friends, but become mentors to me.
Mm-hmm.
So we get together for accountability, to pray, to catch up. It was just much more than another pastor friend from another church.
Mm-hmm.
Just never really felt like we're competing. It felt like we're all working toward the same goal, and we're learning, right. We're sharing about what we're learning. And I really would say I felt when people ask me about the years I have spent here, and that there's a degree of longevity here. And I felt like that level of fellowship, that level of friendship that we shared, really is another factor that helps sustain. That there was just something very special that we shared, and then gradually that grew go into a fellowship, and right. You know, we started meeting up with other pastors or CBC pastors and part of it, and then later on, and actually, for a long time there was a group called CMT, called Chinese Ministry of Texas.
Okay.
It's an English pastors gathering in Texas. So mm-hmm. people from all pastors from Austin, Dallas, and Houston would get together. And back in those days, it was mainly like Austin Chinese Church, DCBC, mm-hmm. and HCC. And that's why just the big churches.
Mm-hmm.
But right. then later on when I came, it marked a second wave of newer, younger guys.
Mm-hmm.
And we just all just hit it off and just really, we just really enjoy being together. And then some years later, we changed the name from CMT to PAC, which is a partnership mm-hmm. right. of Asian American mm-hmm. churches in Texas.
Right.
So PAC is now much larger now. They represent about 12 or 13 Chinese churches. I don't remember exactly now. And so that fellowship has become something very special to me personally, mm-hmm. and I think to a lot of the pastors. Mm-hmm. So we ended up doing a lot of different things. So in some sense, PAC as a fellowship, I think has deeper relational ties than say the Chinese speaking counterparts.
Okay.
Like, meaning the pastors between these different cities, the Chinese pastors between these different cities, they are connected, but very loosely.
Right, right.
But they don't have something like PAC. And PAC among the English-speaking pastors and the youth pastors, it just formed a bond that where we just, actually, when we do something together, it's almost an excuse to get together. And so we're just really great to be together. And I felt mm-hmm. like that. That was something that God had been very merciful with us, and was really instrumental for all the developments. I think it helped like everybody to kind of help each other, growing in support of each other mm-hmm. till this day. Yeah.
So why do you kind of think that is? Like, why do you think the Chinese speaking pastors at Chinese churches are more loosely close to each other, whereas the English speaking pastors at Chinese churches are like more tight knit? Do you think there's like a cultural kind of factor in it?
Might be. It's really a tough call. You go to places, because I've heard people telling me like places like California or Chicago or New York where Chinese churches have run a much longer history, but they don't have similar phenomena.
So
I felt like it really is a, I really see it in a way as a special grace of God, where a special group of people coming together, and we just really admire and respect each other and just become fast friends. And so nowadays, you know, it would be like Pastor Gaylord in Austin, or, or now, so also the younger group now, like Pastor David Tan and DCBC, or even seeing like younger guys like Jason and Jason Tong. Just like, it just has been a really a life-giving fellowship. But I would say though, I think the Chinese speaking fellowship is also growing. But also because a lot of time there's more turnovers.
I
think the turnovers affect the fellowship. In the heart of PAC, some of the key people involved, these are people all have stayed a long time. Look at Pastor Fred, you know, I think I've been here a long time. Pastor Fred just, you know, put me to shame. So that longevity, I think also make those friendship more special.
Interesting. Yeah, that's interesting. And so were you like the first English pastor at W, or was
yes.
the first one? Okay. And so did that kind of start the English ministry, the entire English ministry, or?
Yeah, well when I came, there was a youth ministry. So, you know, we call it English ministry. So we started on that. Yeah, but you know, we learned so much from our sister churches at ECC, and that there was just a lot of great things happening there. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so what is like W's ultimate mission? Do they have like a mission statement?
We have updated a several version of it. I think a earlier version that we used called Sharing the Journey of Life Transformation in Christ. And I would say that, you know, life transformation has always been at the heart of our mission. Even though right now we have some different versions of it, and in fact, we're actually redoing another version for our 30th anniversary coming up next year. But the whole idea of life transformation has always been at the heart of, I think, our mission. We felt like we want to see, as we minister to both Chinese Americans and everybody, our neighbors here, that we want to see people's lives changed because of Jesus Christ.
I see.
I was just going to say that a conviction I've kind of always kind of had, and this kind of dawned on me a number of years ago. You know, I'm actually quite interested in history and Chinese history as a kid. And you know, Chinese boast a very long history. I was just thinking, I said, you know, if Chinese boasts 5,000 years of history, and there were many golden eras, you know, the Han Dynasty, the Tang Dynasty. But I was saying that, I said, you know, I felt like for the Chinese Americans here, I thought, is it reasonable to propose or postulate that this generation of Chinese Americans here with the material blessing and the opportunity and the freedom and the prosperity, the availability to us, could it be that this generation of Chinese Americans actually might be some of the most blessed or most abundantly provided for of all the generations in 5,000 years, even in the golden era of the Chinese history, they would not have the kind of diversity, the kind of opportunity, or the kind of, so I would argue that, I'm not sure I can prove the case, but I would like to think that it is a, not an unreasonable speculation to say that, you know, we'll be among over 5,000 years of, you know, countless trillions of humanity in China that has birthed, that we will be some of the most blessed with opportunity. And if that's so, what does God want to do with us? And if to whom much is given, much is required, that would make a great sense for us to try to do great things with this generation, because we're so blessed was resources, learning, opportunity, to do great things for God.
Yeah, that's interesting. And so what is kind of like your goal, your personal goal as the senior pastor at WU?
Oh, that's a good question. I think what I just shared is definitely connected to a part of it. I do feel like, you know, it's very easy for us to become a comfortable, inward-focused community.
Mm-hmm.
Because most of, you know, whether it be your parents, or I myself being first generation in that sense too,
mm-hmm.
Or one and a half, depending on how you measure it.
Yeah.
Most came here for so-called a better life.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But I like to think that in God's plan, we're not here for a better life. We're here for, there's a greater purpose to serve.
Mm-hmm.
And so I feel my job at the end of the day is to help. And I felt like as a community, you know, we're a community of our own right.
And a
force in our community, that how can we play the role and fulfill the destiny that God called us here for,
mm-hmm.
whether it be becoming a sending base for the sake of the gospel around the world, which is something we aspire to continue to be a sending church, which I feel like HCC was that way, is that way too.
Mm-hmm.
Would it be mm-hmm. continue to multiply with the work of multiplication locally,
mm-hmm.
in terms of planting more churches that would be outwardly thinking, that would be a blessing to our community, that would bring about transformation?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I just think that my purpose would be trying to make sure that we don't become inward focused, but we can fulfill the diverse possibility that God has invested in this community here to do great things for God. A story that I like to share often is when Jamie Taylor, which is Hudson Taylor's great grandson,
mm-hmm.
He spoke at ACC before. He's a very popular speaker. Uh-huh. So anyway, so he was sharing with me us about, I think it was when he went back to England, where the town where Hudson Taylor grew up in, and he mm-hmm. went to church there. That's where Hudson Taylor had gone to church as a child.
Mm-hmm.
And when they shared, they made a quick presentation about what God has done through mm-hmm. Hudson, through Jamie Taylor and Hudson Taylor, just the Taylor family in China, all that. And he said that the elder of the church said, you know, it was so great to hear about all these great things that have been done. And he said, you know, we're so glad that a son of England had helped so many in China to know Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
He said, but I need to tell you that today we're not in the same shape anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And he said that we're praying that maybe a son of China will help reverse the tide mm-hmm. where they are right now. So I just thought that I think Asian American, as we take increasing leadership in various fields, you know, it used to be mainly in technology or in trades, but now it's increasingly in tech, in education, in politics, mm-hmm. in nonprofit leadership. You know, recently I was musing with someone about how several key leaders key Christian nonprofit in the city of Houston are led by, you know, young Asian American women who are just doing great things. I was just saying, you know, that's what a great thing to see, you know. And so I just feel like that, you know, we have to, we're not here to receive a blessing. We're here to be a blessing.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, I think whatever that may be, I hope I can lead our church to facilitate that process
mm-hmm.
so that locally, internationally, cross-culturally, that our church can help make a difference
mm-hmm.
In terms of transforming our world with the gospel.
Yeah, that's great. And so does W like do any I think, I guess what you kind of what you mentioned, cross-cultural outreach, as in trying to bring in more non-Chinese Americans or non-Asian Americans into the church?
Or it's limited. It's mm-hmm. limited. I would say that represents some of the challenges facing like churches of our kind.
Right.
I feel something is happening already in the sense of just through intercultural marriages that we're mm-hmm. seeing people coming together. But yeah. I also think that, and this is part of the struggle too. I think God is raising up some of our young people with an aspiration to lead multicultural congregations and churches. Mm-hmm. Okay. And we already see that. So both my church and HCC, Houston Chinese Church, have people, young guys that I respect a great deal, that's today serving as leaders of multicultural mm-hmm. churches mm-hmm. Around the country.
Right.
But at the same time, I do feel that I'm not quite ready to turn WACC, try to move it into fully multicultural mm-hmm. for a couple of reasons. One of them would be that the percentage of reached people in the city, say in terms of Chinese Americans, mm-hmm. you know, just all generations, it's right. less than 10%. It's less than 10%. Mm. But whether you want to talk about white American, Black American, Latino Americans, mm-hmm. In terms of their gospel penetrations in any of those ethnic groups, I would say they're all multiple times where we are. Mm-hmm. So I felt like that the needs among Chinese American remain substantial. So that's one thing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But more than that, I do feel that the place of where we can maybe do more is how can we leverage the immigrant experience and the heritage that we carry, and mm-hmm. to help even other immigrant community to be successful and sharing our resources and that.
Right.
So, you know, so we before the pandemic, we were hosting a Vietnamese church and a Russian church W. And we were really interested to see, okay, how can we maybe more than just providing space, but to begin to go to the next step, to start thinking about how can we help so that ministry among these other, diverse groups, that gospel can flourish among them.
Mm-hmm.
And so, yeah, I do think that ethnic congregation or ethnic churches, or nowadays, I think we're trying to come up with a new terminology, which is the Chinese Heritage Church.
Mm-hmm.
If you talk to Jason, he would talk about that language. And I like that heritage language. Mm-hmm. I think there's a rich heritage that's not just meant for us to be successful in doing business or thrive where we go and mm-hmm. being a good student or whatever, but that how can we bring that to help get to live up God's intention for this immigrant community that started as an immigrant community, but now, you know, is much more than an immigrant community.
Right. Yeah. Interesting. And so what is the current composition of the congregation at W right now, the English and Chinese?
I would say, you know, our Chinese congregation is definitely still larger. Our Mandarin congregation, I would say, is probably represent 60-65% of the total. We have maybe 15%, maybe Cantonese, maybe 25% English speaking.
I
would say another issue in the English speaking is that I think most of the English speaking congregation, being an English pastor, former English pastor, so myself,
right.
If you talk to most English speaking pastors, that evangelism work for English speaking ministry in Chinese churches are notoriously difficult. And this has been something that we haven't really solved. It is particularly disheartening Because when the English-speaking pastors compared their ministry to, say, the Chinese-speaking counterparts, mm-hmm. like the Chinese side is baptizing, you know, 20 right. you know, people at a time, and English-speaking mm-hmm. maybe baptizing, you know, 7 or 8 with 5 mm-hmm. youth.
right.
you know, so, but again, I think that dynamic does come in to play, that the Chinese side has some advantage in reaching out to fellow immigrants
mm-hmm.
who often seem to have maybe a slightly more receptive heart mm-hmm. to help from the gospel or from church.
Yeah.
And English-speaking next generation just have that much more options. That they don't necessarily need to go to a Chinese church in yeah, speaking yeah. ministry. So that naturally makes the your evangelism or outreach work more challenging.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And I feel like, I also feel like because, I mean, immigrants from China and Taiwan, they haven't been coming to America for, you know, like that long, just maybe like 5-6 generations. I like don't know anyone in the right. sixth generation. Mm-hmm. So I guess the English congregation is relatively younger, mm-hmm. You know, like most of them coming from the youth. And there's definitely like a difference in culture between the youth and like the Chinese speaking adults. I don't know if that has kind of some sort of play into that as well.
Definitely, I think it used to definitely play that way, but I think we have, for the most part, at least in our more sizable churches, I like to think we are moving away from seeing English-speaking ministry as just a glorified youth ministry,
mm-hmm.
but to have the same, to share the same level of respect, and to see that the English-speaking congregation and generation can play a very active leadership role in the mm-hmm. overall of Chinese church. Ultimately, I truly believe the future belongs to that group. Mm-hmm. And ultimately, I do believe that we need to actively prepare for that, to empower mm-hmm. that, and to be very open to how we can think outside the box
mm-hmm.
In the way we do ministry, in the way we engage the next generation with the gospel.
Yeah. And so how have you kind of seen the size of the Chinese and Cantonese congregations change since you started at W versus the English congregation?
It's a hard thing to say because we each time when we church plant, we send away people.
Mm-hmm.
But definitely, we definitely are still seeing stronger growth in the Chinese congregations.
But
I feel the English speaking congregation is making inroads in a deeper desire to grow in our evangelistic fervor. Mm-hmm. You know, for instance, I'll give you an example. Like I will hear this kind of story regularly. Like in the Chinese side, somebody went to get a haircut. And the next person getting haircut, some new person, and they start talking. And next thing you know, they invited that person to come to church, which mm-hmm, they invited mm-hmm, into their mm-hmm. small group. I just don't hear that kind of story very often. from the English speaking, don't hear that.
Yeah,
you know.
Sure.
But I feel like the pandemic and our current situation actually has an interesting effect of forcing us to think more about our neighborhood. You know, because you know how when we are just kind of going to church, you know, out of our neighborhood, you know, because neither our church is a totally community church, you know, maybe mm-hmm. Fort Bend is more community church, Katy maybe more community church. We downplay neighborhood because we commute to our mm-hmm. church, we commute to our work, we all that. But I think the pandemic has an effect of kind of forcing us to think more again about mm-hmm. why community matters and neighborhoods matter, and how we can be an impact on that. And that Houston being the most diverse city in America, our neighborhood is a microcosm of mm-hmm. so many different people groups. and how our English speaking could take lead in that way to connect and to befriend, and especially in this day and age with the tension in the political field. I hope our people can be kind of the person of peace in the neighborhood that could that could help facilitate conversation, that could help neighbors to know and love each other and to and to see why Jesus come to help us to love God and love neighbors.
And actually one of my supervisors, she was like going through your interviews, and I think she found the one where you spoke with Houston Response in April. She wanted me to like ask about, or I think in the interview you touched on how people are like now more receptive than ever to these kind of spiritual conversations in this like kind of political, very tense kind of situation. And then I think you also mentioned how W started launching like different small groups around Houston, or was that?
Well, we started some new small groups in communities where we didn't have small groups before.
Okay.
Because and I wish we could do more, but it's not as easy. But I'm very excited. In particularly some of that's happening more. We have some English small groups starting too, but more happening is more it was our Chinese speaking groups out in Cyprus, where a lot of people are moving down out there. That's kind of like maybe the future Sugar Land or Katie, you know, 10 years, in 10 years. So we have brand new groups that started out there. And we're just really excited because some of those groups started just at the beginning of the pandemic. And most recently, you know, we have baptism for people. I was in, we did kind of the swim pool baptism. So we went to people's home and we did that there. And it was just really moving. I was just really excited to see that. So most of our church planning work that we've done start with the cell group basis, where just starting with one small group, multiplying to two groups, you know, to four group, and then when you reach a certain number of small group, then we can really talking about how a church can actually be birthed out of that. So so that's definitely a part of that. Now the I feel like since the Houston Respond interview, things have changed so much again. Was the environment has become so much more toxic. You know, I almost feel like that interview almost feel like eons ago now, because that was more at the beginning of the pandemic, where I felt there was a lot of talk about, you know, we're in it together. Remember they were talking about that. I'm just not hearing people say we're in it together anymore. I'm hearing people like, you know, saying like, you know, people saying each other, you know, you're listening to fake news. I do feel we have a place in that. We're still struggling trying to figure that out. We did some town hall, kind of an online town hall to talk about this. We invited African American pastor to join us and people to talk about and conversation about that. But we really need to figure out some of the next step to continue the conversation. But I feel I do feel the pressure and the tension where some of that divisiveness is even seeping into the church. And I feel that the problem, I don't see the problem as just, you know, whether your politics is more conservative or more liberal.
Right.
I feel like we're not really listening to each other. I feel like we are not reflecting more deeply about our own blind spots. And I feel like the there's a lack of humility that we have with our neighbors. So the discussion, I feel like we're letting what's happening in the political realm taking lead, even in the way we do relationship with our neighbors or our friends. Like I know people who got mad with their friends because they see things differently and they started arguing and debating and in the social media sphere, people even calling names at each other. And but again, I think, I feel like, you know, Jesus came to reconcile the world unto himself, and we're given a ministry of reconciliation. So I like to think the church should have a place here, and that the Chinese church can play an important role here, but we're still trying to figure that one out, how that should look like.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you have any like brainstormed ideas yet? It's a tough thing, you know.
But I feel like, you know, as with the gospel, you know, Jesus doesn't do gospel like instant conversion of millions of people.
Right.
Although I think God can do that. But Jesus saves people one at a time as each person come to know his love and experience the gospel.
Mm-hmm.
So it seemed kind of slow and ineffective, inefficient, but it's actually a very powerful thing. And I like to think maybe at the end of the day, it's still just us loving our neighbors who may hold to very different belief, and because of Jesus, and that we're showing the fact that, you know, we're not going to let that kind of thing divide us, and that we recognize that some may give much more credence to law and order because of the way they were raised and the world view they have, because sometimes we don't see things as they really are. Sometimes we really see things as we want to see them. So I think if we bear each other's burden more and speak with more humility and just love our neighbors, I think maybe at a grassroots level, we can turn the tide that is countering all the, you know, the poisonous stuff that's going on in the news. I think we need to watch a little less news.
Yeah, that's funny. That's true. Have you kind of tried to integrate like the current situation, the current like, you know, political tension conversations into your own preaching?
We'll do it a little bit, but I have to say, you know, we're learning how to do some of these things. We have talked about that. We most recently did our reopening service, and that's what we talked about. We're really urging people to recognize that for believers, there is no change. In the sense of the leadership of God has not changed, that the political leaders landscape may change, and that not to put too much of our hope in political system. I think it's fair to have convictions, but knowing that no human leadership will ultimately bring the satisfaction that we're longing for.
But I
would say it is challenging, especially because a good part of evangelical church is right in the thick of this. And that makes the conversation harder because people read and watch and listen to all variety of sources. I also think we are not praying enough. I don't think we're praying for our country enough. I don't think we're praying for ourselves enough. And I don't think we are, and I don't think we're loving our enemies enough. We're becoming emotionally charged too easily, far too easily.
Yeah. And something I've been like talking about with my friends is how I've noticed there's been a pretty general shift of I guess mostly the youth in Chinese American churches towards a more left-leaning kind of ideology, whereas, you know, traditionally just Christians or Chinese churches are more conservative. I guess, like, do you have any thoughts on that as well? And maybe how that can play into?
Yeah, certainly depends on who you're talking to, because some people would say, my kids are thinking that way because their teachers and their schools are liberal and they've been brainwashing my kids. I wouldn't, rule out 100%, there's no shreds of truth in the more progressive thinking in the academic community. But I don't think that's the whole story. I do think that there's always a pendulum swing in history, where you go to one side now, it's gonna self-correct, kind of coming back.
Mm-hmm.
And I just feel like, evangelicalism over the years, we value life, we're pro-life, and we want to support our government, we're pro-law and order, and that leads to a number of positions, things like that. But I feel like, but when you look at the Bible and what the gospel teaches, it isn't all just about that.
Mm-hmm.
There is very much a sign about loving the poor and Jesus being with the poor. There is very much a call for social justice and justice.
Mm-hmm.
And I like to think that it's kind of similar to, Jesus talking to the Pharisees and said that, it's not choosing one or the other, but you have to have both.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like our younger generation, a part of what they're clamoring for, what they're talking about, is a part of our previous focal point, evangelical church, pro-life and all that, or morality, mm-hmm. which is still important, in terms mm-hmm. of sexuality and our understanding about that.
Right.
But I think what is moving the other direction is seeing that there's an aspect of grace, there's an aspect of social justice, mm-hmm. there's an aspect of loving the poor, that we need both.
Right.
So again, that's why we were encouraging our families. I said, let's have conversation about this. Let's not jump the gun to shut the other side down about mm-hmm. nothing. But we really need to learn to listen and to understand. And I encourage our young people to ask their parents or grandparents about their experiences of maybe discrimination,
mm-hmm.
of facing lawlessness, or mm-hmm. seeing what happened maybe in, like my mom remember when she was a child fleeing as part of refugees
mm-hmm.
Out of China. And when you had lived through like that kind of world, when there's lawlessness and things, it's gonna profoundly shape the way you think about what matters, what is important. So mm-hmm. I feel like we need to do deeper listening. Mm-hmm. When we're just listening to the superficial rhetorics and getting mad about it, instead of really listening to, where you've been, our interests really have to be more than just what people believe, but also who they are.
Mm-hmm.
And I think doing gospel in this next phase, next generation, I grew up doing the four spiritual laws and things mm-hmm. like that. And where you find that, sometimes just sharing those things nowadays, people just like, what are you talking about? And I feel like people nowadays, we have to rethink about how can we incarnate the gospel for people to see that, okay, you're listening to me. And now, I'm opening to hear what you have to say. And I'm beginning to understand why I can respect, even though I may not agree with you, but I can respect that you have your view. I begin to understand what does that mean. Even if that person's life or the belief may be very, very opposite to what we believe is right.
Mm-hmm.
We may need to first just be able to have that basis first. And I think that's what Jesus mm-hmm. did too. So he would befriend and talk to adulterous women and Samaritan women and tax collectors,
right. Mm-hmm.
Whom we will probably outright condemn as, you know, hopeless, infidels.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's interesting. And do you think there are any, like, opportunities for specifically Chinese Americans, or I guess people from Chinese American churches, to kind of engage in these political conversations that maybe non-Chinese churches don't?
Needs a lot of wisdom, because you know, something like Chinese church in general, you know, in the culture, our culture is one. Just think, you know, the first generations of immigrants here, you know, they try to survive. That has survival mindset. So therefore, there's a strong mindset to not to rock the boat, not to make too much noise. Don't draw undue attention onto yourself. Uh-huh. Be careful. I think we're gradually moving out of that shadow. You see Asian American leaders not, you know, they're gaining voices in the world and that. So that's an exciting development. But I think for churches to have these discussions, say between generations or between the different language conversations,
mm-hmm.
it really needs a lot of wisdom.
Mm-hmm.
Because so quickly you could step on the red line or step on a landmine and mm-hmm. just blow everybody up. Because people mm-hmm. so yeah. easily jump in. Especially you look at this, so many complexity now. You got the tension between US and China that's going on. You get the situation in Taiwan.
Yeah.
And you get to sing about, people talk about, you know, COVID, you know, whereas, you know, being a, you know, blame it on China.
Right.
There are so many complex threads of storyline that's at work.
Mm-hmm.
So I would say treading carefully but intentionally, wisely is important.
Mm-hmm.
So, but I do think that it's possible.
Mm-hmm.
And I would love to see, you know, our churches kind of growing in those areas for people mm-hmm. just to learn to share about where people are coming from, why they think things a certain way. And to beginning to move, shifting out of that adversarial dialogue into mm-hmm. one where we're increasingly finding common ground and finding that Jesus is in that place,
mm-hmm.
you know, and that this isn't, you know, because I think you could just see Pharisees. If you want to imagine Jesus today, you could just see Republicans and Democrats want to force him to take a side. In that conversation, right?
You
can just see that they sort of trick him and sort of force him to say, to choose one side over mm-hmm. the other. And then you can just see Jesus, who was able to dodge, you know, whether giving to Caesar is the right thing or not.
Mm-hmm.
You can just see Jesus very wisely treading in a way mm-hmm. of not letting any side to think they own him.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true. That's interesting. And I guess another thing that I've been curious about is, like, for the youth of maybe specifically WHCC or Chinese American churches, once they go off into college and then go start working, have you seen them, like, come back to Chinese churches, or do you see them mostly going to more, like, non-Chinese churches?
A few. Most of them do not come back.
Okay.
I would say, well, first of all, many do not come back to Houston.
Once
they see Austin, once they see some other places, yeah. they say, oh man, there's such a good place that's not this human.
Right.
I think that's just how it is. But I do mm-hmm. think Houston offers some unique things. And I think it's more important that we make sure that our students graduating will value their local church involvement, and that mm-hmm. they will not just participate, but they will help to be leaders wherever they go, and that they will mm-hmm. be an influence for the gospel.
Mm-hmm.
But some do come back, which we're very grateful for. But another interesting thing I find out is that, you know, after doing ministry for a number of years, you know, we tend to see things in a very short timeline. But I think we need to see everything in large, longer timeline and what God is doing. So I share the story sometime. I ran into a guy, and I think it was in Boston someplace, and talked to this new guy. And he was new at that Chinese church. I said, oh, he's, and I was just getting to know him a little bit. So he shared with me, you know, his background. And you know, he was born in America, and he grew up in this really awesome American church. It was a really famous pastor. I was like, wow. I said, you know, that's so awesome. I said, you grew up listening to him preach. He said, oh, yeah, it was so great. And then I was just kind of, what are you doing here? why are you here? And so this is a man in his like late 40s,
right?
And he said, you know, Pastor Davis, I'm very comfortable, very at home in my old church environment, but as I got older and I raised kids, I said there's something, I felt like there's still something missing. And he said that you can say that I'm here partly because of that. I'm looking for something connected to my roots, and I'm seeing some needs here. I'm seeing something. And he didn't have an answer, but he just told me that he said, I'm searching for something here. And I think, you know, two of the most challenging things of going to the future, I think, for us in theology is in sexuality and ethnicity. Both are studies of anthropology, because we have the church had debate about what God is like, what church is like, what salvation is like, and all these things. But the one area the church hasn't done a lot of work historically is particularly in the area of thinking about what human sexuality really means, and genders, and as well as this issue of ethnicity, to think more deeply, instead of just thinking about nations as in rivals and the rivalry between nations, or you know, as Chinese people, I mean, we have a pretty high level of cultural snobbishness and pride. You know, we think, you know,
right, exactly,
it's pretty awesome. Not to mention, we think our food is pretty awesome. So I think ethnicity roots, there is much more to it than I think we're not really understood yet. And therefore I feel that I don't think just plain multicultural or multi-ethnic church has answered the whole question yet. Because a lot of time in the way we do these multi-ethnic congregation is really whitewashing everything into American culture. But I really think at the end of the day, it's gonna have to be something that's actually broader than that, that's more diverse than that, where there's actually a celebration of the multiple culture for kingdom.
So I think
there's a lot we need to learn. I think that's going to be a big part about reaching the next generation too, because our next generation, like yourself, you all grew up more open-minded and more with a more ability to engage in diverse culture and thinking than any generations before.
Interesting. I guess, what are kind of your future outlooks for Chinese American churches in Houston specifically? How do you think they'll change?
I'm very hopeful. I like to think some very exciting things will be coming up, because the reason is, even though I think it will be hard, I think things will be hard for the church. I don't think it will get easier regardless of the outcome of elections or politics, because I just think it's harder now. But I'm hopeful, because the people I know, When I see some of the younger pastors in our church, when I see people like Jason at your church, when I mm-hmm. see some of these guys, I love them so much and respect them so much. When I see some of the young leaders, or even like yourself, Helen, I feel extremely hopeful, because I feel like our next generation leaders, how God is going to use to lead us through a lot of these nebulous times, mm-hmm. Even though we may not have the answer today.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the easy answer, the quick 3-point answer that solves everything in your life and the problem of the world, I think that has kind of, that's dissipating with the previous era. Mm-hmm. This is more a more complex and requires a more holistic kind of thinking and listening. Mm-hmm. But mm-hmm. I feel hopeful for our churches moving forward, because I think I see the people and I believe in the people. But mm-hmm. I think it will be challenging. And it would not surprise me also that it's a very hard season for churches in general, even coming on a pandemic, may be in store for us. Mm-hmm. As we struggle to figure out in person and online and all these complexity. And even as we struggle with how busy we are, you know, we're all just like overly busy. But I think God is at work in our churches,
mm-hmm.
and therefore I believe that good things to come.
Yeah, that's great. And do you have any advice for the leadership of Chinese American churches in terms of living through this era?
I don't know about advice. I just think, the two things I myself trying to state was, I feel like, stay hungry, stay humble, mm-hmm. Stay hungry and keep learning, because mm-hmm. I don't know everything, and there's lots mm-hmm. of things to learn in the new world we're in, and stay humble, and realizing that, if God can teach a prophet with a donkey, and speak to a prophet with a donkey, I think we can learn a lot from our neighbors and from each other.
Mm-hmm.
And being hungry and humble, I have found has helped navigating through mm-hmm. a lot of kind of tricky times. So I just feel like if we stay hungry and humble before God and with each other, I think there's sufficient grace. And I look forward to see a new generation. We've sent out some people into global fields and things. I'm just so proud of them and seeing the kind of work they're doing. I know there are young people who have great aspiration. I know people want to see the joining of their career with faith, how to live out their faith in career in a special way. I think it's going to be awesome to see how God is going to unfold that storyline.
Yeah, that's great. Well, that's all the questions I have. Is there anything else that you would like to add that maybe we didn't touch on?
No, that's a lot. That's a lot. I mean, you're asking a ton of questions. When you sent me the list of questions, I was looking at it. I said, oh, man, we could be here all day.
Yeah, but thank you so much again. Everything was so inspirational.